to take a moment as we get started this morning to thank you for, many of you have asked about Mom, if you haven't heard, didn't hear, or didn't get the news, Mom had fallen a week ago, this past Tuesday, broke her hip. Mom is 95 years old. As I've told many of you, she is nearly deaf, and besides that, she can't see. So that's not a good combination. Her vision is not good. Her hearing is not good. And she broke her hip. And she suffers some from dementia. Other than that, she's doing really well. She's back at the nursing home. My wife was able to stay and help take care of her and help her to get acclimated back to nursing home life. And I've told several of you this morning that before my wife flew home last night, she had gone to the nursing home to one final visit with Mom, and Mom wasn't in her room. So she asked some of the help, "Where's Helen?" And they said, "She's down in the community room playing piano." So that was a good thing. And so we're thankful for all your prayers and for your support for her and our family. Well, we're going to be concluding our High Calling sermon series this morning. So we're going to be in the sixth chapter, and I want to just take a moment to share the first few verses, and we're going to concentrate then on the section about the armor of God, which I think is very, very important. Zach did an excellent job last week sharing about the relationship, specifically the husband and wife marriage relationship, and then there's in the start of chapter 6, there's some additional information there about relationships, and I want to just highlight that for a moment, and then we'll move into to the part about the armor of God. So, if you have a Bible or if you have a Bible app on your phone, Ephesians chapter 6, the first verse says, "Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right." Children, if you consider yourself a child here, and some of you adults do, raise your hand. So this is for you. Yeah, I see that hand, Otis. Me too. I'm one of God's children. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Obey. How are we doing with that obedience thing? Obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with a promise that it may go well with you and that you may enjoy long life on earth. You know, this whole obedience, authority thing, a lot of our problems in this country would be solved. A lot of the issues with police would be solved if we just knew how to respond to authority. Amen? Some of you may disagree, and that's fine, but I believe that it starts at the home, so it's very important for us to hear these words. Children, obey your parents. Fathers, parents, do not exasperate your children. Instead, bring them up in the training and the instruction of the Lord. So parents have a great responsibility in training their children. The Bible is very clear about that idea of passing on our faith and teaching our children the ways of the Lord. Slaves, now, this probably doesn't apply to us, but we can use the term employee, okay? Slaves, obey your earthly masters with respect and fear and with sincerity of heart, just as you would obey Christ. Obey them not only to win their favor when their eye is on you, but like slaves of Christ, do the will of God from your heart. Serve wholeheartedly as if you were serving the Lord, not men, because you know that the Lord will reward everyone for whatever good he does, whether he is slave or free. And masters, treat your slaves, employers, treat your employees in the same way. Do not threaten them, since you know that he who is both their master and yours is in heaven, and there is no favoritism with him. So we can apply that slave-master relationship to employee-employer relationships. If you're an employee, give it your best. If you get paid for 8 hours, work 8 hours. If you're making a salary, work as if you're working wholeheartedly and working for the Lord. So those are some instructions about relationships. Parents, children, employee, employers. So the next section then, this message I'm calling Standing Strong in Our Calling. Standing Strong in Our Calling. We'll be looking primarily at verses 10 through 20. Let's go ahead and read the text, and then we'll break it down a little bit more and talk about what God might be saying to us here in Ephesians chapter 6. And I hope this series has been helpful to you, that you have sensed God's high calling on your life, and that you have been challenged to live up to that high calling. Verse 10, finally, be strong in the Lord and in His mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you have done everything, to stand. Stand firm, then, with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, and pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the saints. Pray also for me, Paul writes, that whenever I open my mouth, words may be given me so that I will fearlessly make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it fearlessly as I should. So I want to talk about, first of all, in verse 10, tapping into an unlimited resource. So the Bible says here, finally, be strong in the Lord and in His mighty power, in verse 10. Be strong in the Lord and in His mighty power. The psalmist, I think it's a psalm of ascent. I'm not sure that David wrote this psalm. He well could have. The psalmist said in Psalm 121, I will lift up my eyes into the hills. Where does my help come from? Not from the hills. My help comes from the Lord. My help comes from the Lord. There's a favorite Bible passage in a story about King David. Back in 1 Samuel, chapters, the latter chapters, 30, 29 and 30. If you remember the story of David, as a young shepherd boy, King Saul was the first king of Israel, and he was an impressive dude. Says he was a head taller than everybody else, and he did well to begin with, but as you know, he disobeyed the Lord, and God took his hand of his anointing off of King Saul. And he basically said, you know, the kingdom is not going to be you're not going to be king any longer. But King Saul was still in office, and Samuel, the prophet, went and found the son of Jesse, young David, which was the least expected to be the next king, and anointed him as king. But Saul was still in power. So you have this political situation where Saul is still in power, but David is God's appointed, God's anointed for leadership. And as you may know the story, King Saul, David went and fought Goliath, and he became a military hero and was a great military leader. And King Saul became insanely jealous and tried to kill him on numerous occasions. And then David was on the run, had opportunities to take the king's life, but he said, no, I will not take the life of the king. So finally, David, in frustration, decides, okay, he's chasing after me. The only place I can be safe is to ally myself with the enemy. And so he goes to hang out with the Philistines. Kind of unthinkable, but this is what King David did. Soon to be King David. So he had a ragtag army of some 600 men, and they went and allied themselves with the Philistines. Well, the Philistines decided, as they were going to go to battle with the people of Israel, that it might be not a good idea to have David with us. So he might turn on us and he might fight against us, although he had been loyal to the leadership and to the Philistines. The Philistines had given David and his army and their families a place to live, Ziklag. And they had established homes and were living in that area. I want to pick up the story. Basically, that when the Philistine leader said, we don't want David with us, and David was basically sent home with him and his army. So let's pick it up in 1 Samuel chapter 30. So they're sent home. They're heading back to Ziklag. It says in 1 Samuel chapter 30, verse 1, David and his men reached Ziklag on the third day. But when they reached it, it wasn't a good scenario. Now the Amalekites had raided the Negev and Ziklag. They had attacked Ziklag and burned it and had taken captive the women and all who were in it, both young and old. They killed none of them but carried them off as they went on their way. So they come back to their homes and they are burned to the ground. Have any of you ever suffered from a fire situation? Have your home burned, lost possessions? Our church in Monroe City that I pastored for 39 years in 2005, February of 2005, we lost our facility to fire. And I don't wish that on anybody. I've jokingly said to people, I always wanted to pastor a church that was on fire, but not in that way, spiritually on fire. But through all of that, God blessed us and honored us, and we were able to build back out of the ashes to build something that continues to serve and to glorify God. But that feeling of seeing your place of worship, as we stood outside that building on that Friday afternoon and watched our beloved church building burn, it was an awful, awful, discouraging feeling. But realizing out of that, we realized that the church is not a building. The church is people. We need to remember that. We need to remember that. The important part of a church is the people, the heart of the people. And our people were determined to go on. And by the time Sunday rolled around, we were meeting in the high school auditorium. And over 300 people showed up for our first worship there in that auditorium. And God honored and blessed the faithfulness of the people who continue to be committed. So David and his men get back to Ziklag, and they find it burned to the ground. And all of their family, women and children, young and old, had been carried off. Verse 3, when David and his men came to Ziklag, they found it destroyed by fire, and their wives and sons, daughters, taken captive. So David and his men wept aloud until they had no strength left to weep. They were distraught. They were discouraged. They were despondent. David's two wives had been captured. Ahinoam of Jezreel and Abigail, the widow of Nabal of Carmel. Now, this is the verse I want you to hear. David was greatly distressed because the men were talking of stoning him. Each one was bitter in spirit because of his sons and daughters. David was between a rock and a hard place. David was discouraged beyond discouragement. He was greatly distressed, as the word says. But note what the concluding sentence of this verse says. But David found strength in the Lord his God. When it comes down to it, when we are faced with insurmountable situations, we need to fall on the providential care and strength of the Lord. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Over and over in the Old Testament and throughout the New Testament, we see that theme played out where people must fall on the strength of the Lord. King Jehoshaphat faced insurmountable odds, and he sent the choir out to sing. And that's where we get the verse, the battle is not yours, but it's the Lord's. In the Lord's strength we battle. We tap into this great resource, unlimited resource, God's strength, God's power. I know probably many of you are familiar with the verses in Isaiah chapter 40, the end of the chapter. It says, "Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the earth, ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope," some translations say, "those who hope, trust in the Lord, those who trust in the Lord will renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not grow weary. They shall walk and not faint." We can tap into an unlimited resource of strength and help. This past weekend, watched three different baseball games. Our 12-year-old grandson's playing. And it wasn't a particularly pretty weekend. They won one out of three, but that's better than none, I guess. So when you talk about baseball, what's more important, offense or defense? Well, they're both probably almost equally important. I think there's statisticians that have figures on which one is actually more important than all these numbers and so forth and so on. But if you can't stop the other team from scoring a lot of runs, you know, it's a simple formula. You need to score more runs than the other team, and then you win. Did you ever figure that out? So if you don't have a good defense, when I was coaching Little League way back in the day on a pitching machine, a lot of the kids, most of the kids learned to hit the ball because the pitch was consistent and they weren't afraid of getting hit. So the key to winning on a pitching machine is having pretty good defense. And so you put your best players up the middle, a good player at the place of the pitching machine position, and your defense is what helps you win a ball game. So I want us to look at the defense that God calls us to as we look at putting on the full armor of God. So, first of all, we need to realize that the necessity of the full armor of God. Why is the full armor of God necessary? Well, it's simple. Because there is a war going on. There is a spiritual war. There is spiritual warfare out there. There are unseen things that we do not readily see with our physical eyes that are happening behind the scenes. The Bible says that Satan is the prince of the power of the air. Now, I think even Christians make two common mistakes in terms of Satan and his work. First of all, sometimes some people give Satan way too much credit, okay? Remember Flip Wilson many years ago? I'm really dating myself here. The devil made me do it, honey. No, the devil can't make you do it. If you are a believer in Christ, the devil can't make you do anything. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. So we need to understand that Satan does not have power over us. So some people give Satan way too much credit. And on the other extreme, some people say, oh, well, there's no such a thing as evil force. There's no such a thing as Satan. In some cases, it's our own sinful desires. And, of course, Satan uses that to get at us and to cause us to do things that we know are simply not right. The necessity of full armor of God is because there is a spiritual war. There is spiritual warfare. And if you've ever experienced a spiritual warfare personally in your own life, I think we do at some level, probably all of us experience that at some level, some discouragement, some disappointments, or things that happen in our lives that just feel like a defeat to us. So, Paul says, put on the full armor of God so that you can stand against the devil's schemes. Now, this whole armor of God posture and position seems to be, to me, to be a defensive one. That you're able to stand over and over, Paul says, stand. So let's look at Ephesians 6, 11 and 12. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. And then in verse 13, he repeats that. Therefore, he says, you're warring against powers, authorities, darkness, powers of dark world against spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground. And after you've done everything, to stand. To stand. So, what does this armor look like? The armor of spiritual warfare. What does it look like? Well, the first thing that Paul talks about, mentions here, is the belt of truth. Now, Paul, when he wrote these words in Ephesians, was under house arrest, and we believe he was chained continuously to a praetorian guard, the elite guard of the Roman military. And so he had this image of a Roman soldier in front of him. And so as God inspired him to write these words, he began describing the parts of a soldier's armor. And the first thing he mentioned is the belt of truth. And this belt for the Roman soldier was a belt with which he tied up and girded up his outer garments. It was also the belt that enabled him to keep his swords and his weapons handy. I meant to bring my work belt with me this morning, and I left it at home. So it's hanging on the chair right where I was supposed to grab it. But I have a tool belt, believe it or not. It's not very well used, okay? My neighbor and I built a pole building. Actually, I helped him, and so I actually got to use my tool belt some. So if you've done any construction work or done that kind of work, you know that having a tool belt, having your hammer handy, having your tape measure handy, or your framing square or pencil or screwdrivers, having those right at your disposal, and having the nails or screws that you need in your project, having them right on your belt is very handy, very helpful. So this is the kind of belt that the soldier wore that had his weapons of war right at hand for him to use. And so this belt of truth is the first part that Paul left there, because without truth, we're lost. The schemes of the devil will surely overpower us. Now, understand, relativism is the norm of our day. What does that mean? It means simply that what is true for me may not be true for you. What is true for you may not be true for me. So I get to pick and choose. So the devil would like to convince us that there is no absolute truth in this world. That's sad, because Jesus said what? I am the way, the truth, and the life. In his high priestly prayer in John chapter 17, Jesus prays, sanctify them or set them apart by the truth. Your word is truth. My friends, this is truth. And we have begun to stray away from the spoken, clear word of God. Yes, there are things that are open to interpretation in here, but the basic fundamental truths of God's word and what God desires for us is right here. So we need the belt of truth if we're going to stand against the devil's schemes. The next thing that I've listed is the breastplate of righteousness. The breastplate of righteousness. With the breastplate of righteousness in place. So this breastplate was a plate or of mail or some kind of a protective covering that covered the vital areas of the body, namely the heart and the lungs. And righteousness is a righteousness for us spiritually that is given to us by Jesus Christ. We stand in His righteousness. The Bible says our righteousness is as filthy rags. We are not right with God on our own. We don't earn or merit the grace that God extends to us. The breastplate of righteousness has Christ's name. It says as if Christ's name is stamped on it, as though He said to us, friend, your righteousness isn't sufficient to protect you. Here, wear mine.
wear mine, the breastplate of righteousness. Then he talks about foot protection, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. Verse 15. Logical. Footwear, proper footwear was important for the ancient soldier. A serious foot injury or slipping could mean certain death. A soldier had to have footwear that gave him sure footing to be able to stand his ground. Their shoes often had nails or studs embedded in them, much like a baseball or a track cleat, so that his foot would not slip. The gospel, readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. Peace is knowing that you can stand your ground. Have you ever tried to walk around on sheer ice that has a little bit of water on top of it? Not good. That's about the time you want cleats or some kind of an extra grip on the bottom of your shoes. Otherwise, you're not going to have peace. You're going to be out very uncertain of your footing and step. Peace is knowing that you can stand your ground. God gives us this peace. Peace in the midst of turmoil. Peace in the midst of the battle. Peace in the midst of the storm. Jesus said, John 14:27, "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled." God gives us peace. We are protected. Our feet are protected. We are on firm standing with the peace that God gives us. Then he talks about the shield of faith. In addition to all of this, Paul says, take up the shield of faith. Now, the Roman soldier's shield was a huge thing that was made out of wood, and it would cover his entire body from head to toe. And it was often made out of wood, and it was covered with some kind of animal hide. And if you wet the shield, if the shield had some wetness, moisture to it, it would extinguish the flaming arrows and the flaming darts. Take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. All believers have this promise found in 1 John 5:4. Everyone born of God overcomes the world. Everyone born of God overcomes the world. This is the victory that has overcome the world, even our faith. Even our faith. The shield of faith for the believer is everything. Faith is the protective barrier between us and the schemes of the devil. We remain grounded in truth. The lies of our enemy lose their power. Their flaming darts are extinguished. We become overcomers. And that way, faith is our shield. Then he talks about the helmet of salvation. Take the helmet of salvation. It seems obvious to me that a soldier's head must be protected. A blow to the head could mean certain death. Salvation. When we talk about salvation, eternity is at stake. Eternity is at stake. So we must put on the helmet of salvation. We must know that we are saved to protect us from the schemes of the devil. Because the devil will call into question our salvation. Will he not? When you make that decision to accept Christ, the devil will be knocking at your door saying, that doesn't mean anything. Yeah, you're not really going to go to heaven when you die. You didn't really accept Christ. You know what the Bible says? It says, he that has the Son has life. He that does not have the Son of God does not have life. It says, these things are written to you who believe, that you might know that you have eternal life. We don't have to have a think-so, maybe-so, hope-so salvation. We can rest assured. We can be confident in our salvation when we have fully accepted and trusted Christ completely for our salvation. The helmet of salvation. And then we come to the sword of the Spirit. Remember, I don't know if girls do this, but boys, they like to have a sword fight, you know? And a sword can be offensive weapon, or it can be a defensive weapon. So boys will take up a couple of sticks or whatever they can find. You know how it goes. You know, if you were raised boys, you know how it goes. And the sword, the Bible says, Paul says, and his analogy says, the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. which is the Word of God. Every good soldier had to learn to be proficient in the use of his sword. The purpose of the sword of the Spirit, the Bible, is to make us strong and enable us to withstand the evils of onslaughts of Satan, our enemy. The psalmist says that, Thy word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against thee. Thy word have I hid in my heart. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. The Holy Spirit uses the power of the word to save our souls. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And then he used the word to give us spiritual strength to be mature soldiers for the Lord in fighting this corrupt an evil world in which we live. The sword of the Spirit, the Word of God. You see, the more we know and understand about God's Word, the more useful we will be doing the will of God, and the more effective we will be in standing against the enemy of our souls. Remember, Jesus resisted Satan through his perfect knowledge of the Word, and Satan tried to twist the Word, but Jesus answered every challenge of Satan by his knowledge of the Word. So that is the armor, that the spiritual armor that we are to put on for taking our stand in spiritual warfare. And finally, in addition, Paul says, and pray. Pray. I'm thankful for this wonderful avenue of communication that we have with the Lord our God. But he always listens, that he's attentive to our prayers. Paul writes in the verse 18, and pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. You know, I find myself, as I get older, turning to God in prayer more than ever in so many different situations. I've learned that if God is impressing on my heart, on my spirit, say, you ought to pray with this person. My wife was flying home yesterday, and during her layover, I believe in Chicago, she saw a lady that was very distressed. And so my wife is not a particularly outgoing person, but I don't know if God just led her to go over and talk to this lady and ask her, well, where are you going to be flying to? Where so far and so on? And the lady started sharing with her that she was sending her daughter off to stay with her uncle because she was having challenges with her 12-year-old daughter. And so Lynn said, you know, I asked her if I could pray with her, and she let me. So pray all occasions, maybe meeting a random person in the airport, with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the saints. What does it mean to pray in the Spirit? Someone suggested that some would suggest that this means praying in tongues. I don't think it does at all. I think it's much more than saying a bunch of words. Believe praying in the Spirit is praying according to the Spirit's leading. And I think Lynn followed the Spirit's leading in ministering to this lady in the airport. It's praying for things the Spirit leads us to pray for. In Romans 8:26, the Bible tells us in the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. Sometimes we don't know how to pray, do we? We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groans, with words that cannot be expressed. Groans that words cannot express. So, Life Point Church, individually and corporately, put on the full armor of God, because Satan does not want this church to move forward and to succeed. Just the opposite. But I believe there is a new day dawning for Life Point Church, and I believe that God has grand plans for this body of believers here in Goshen, Indiana. Put on the full armor of God. Every piece is essential. The belt of truth, the breastplate of righteousness, foot protection, the gospel of peace, the shield of faith, the helmet of salvation, the sword of the Spirit, God's word, all covered by prayer, guided by the Holy Spirit, with all kinds of prayers and requests. So, How's your armor? How's your armor this morning? Are you prepared to stand? Are you prepared to fight? I want us to go through a little spiritual putting on our armor this morning, prayer time. I found this helpful little piece through Navigators, which is a well-known discipleship program, and they do some great work on one-on-one discipleship. So I'm going to lead us, and I would encourage you to pray these simple prayers with me as we close and as we think about putting on the full armor of God. Because let's face it, there is an unseen spiritual battle going on that we most often are oblivious to. Nonetheless, it is real. So, I'm going to read these and just a little prayer on each section of the armor. And I'm going to give you a few seconds to just meditate on it and to pray it in your own heart and spirit. So it goes like this. Equip me, Lord, with the belt of truth. May your truth rule in my heart and be in my mind and on my lips today and in the days ahead. Equip me, Lord, with the breastplate of righteousness. Apart from you, there is no righteousness, but through Jesus I have been born again and made righteous in your sight. May I live as a righteous person. Equip me, Lord, with feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. May I reflect the gospel in my words and actions, that through me, with my every encounter, others may be drawn one step closer to you. Equip me, Lord, with the shield of faith. May I take you at your word concerning promises about the present and the future, promises of everlasting love, abundant life, and so much more. Equip me, Lord, with the helmet of salvation. Remind me that nothing can separate me from your love, and that I have been saved by grace. In your grace, help me to say no to all ungodliness and worldly passions, and to live a self-controlled, upright, and godly life. Equip me, Lord, with the sword of the Spirit, the Word of God. May your Holy Spirit reign in my life and bring to my mind just the right Bible verses to be in my heart and on my lips. May I be filled with the Spirit and ready with Scripture as you were, Jesus, when the devil tempted you. And finally, Lord, keep me in an attitude of prayer. Remind me to pray in the Spirit on all occasions. Cause me to be alert and always praying for the saints, to be joyful and to give thanks in everything. Lord, we need this full armor of God. We know there is evil in our world. There are forces that we don't see, we don't recognize, and sometimes it's easier just not to even think about it or even acknowledge that these things exist, but we know that they're real. We know there's evil in the world. So help us, Lord, as we put on this full armor of God to stand against the wicked schemes of the evil one. Help us to know, Lord, that you are good and you desire good things for us. But you have come that we might have life and have it to the full. So I pray, God, that we would stand strong. I pray for Life Point Church as they look forward to a new chapter in the life of this congregation. Just pray, God, that you would be at work and that they would put on the armor of God individually and corporately as a church body. Thank you for the opportunity we've had to share your word this morning. Help us to live up to the high calling that you have for us. And we'll give you all thanks and praise in the name of Jesus, our conquering Savior and Lord, we pray. Amen.